What phase of the practice are you in? What phase of practice are you in right now? I'm in flipping the script phase. Practice has three phases. Flipping the script phase and tipping the computer phase. There you go. I'm coming out of a tremendous wow phase because for about 7 hours this morning, I have been in intense practice and it's produced a tremendous wow. So I'll just, in the flipping the script phase, I'll just sort of start talking and try to generate, get it back to the assertions that produce the, you know, they'll produce even more stronger wow, but huge, exponentially great progress this morning. Huge breakthroughs. And we need that to stay ahead of the curve right now. The curve is, the world is really crazy, so out of balance. We have to calm ourselves down here, starting this practice, full stop in the wow practice. July 3rd, 2015. This content is extraordinary. We have a different way to look at the world, the universe actually. And the universe is really just the body of arrogance. It's the body of arrogance. And the body of arrogance actually is just a rotting corpse. A rotting cancerous corpse is what the body of arrogance actually is. It's a dream, but it's a dream of a rotting cancerous corpse. And the symptoms of sickness and illness in this body play itself out as stars, as planets, as comets, asteroids, gas clouds, and then as forms, matter forms on the planets, and as bodies, and ultimately as human bodies. These are just symptoms of a disease, of an illness, actually. The whole universe is a dream of arrogance, and the dream of arrogance manifests in the dream as a rotting corpse. It's actually a rotting corpse, what this universe actually is. And in that rotting corpse, there's all sorts of maggots and horrible things that are decaying, collapsing, rotting. You know, this is actually what these bodies are. This is actually what these planets are. And I know this turns everything upside down on most people's belief system, but this is true. It is actually true. And what we are doing, what we try to do, is put lipstick on this pig, on this rotting corpse. We're trying to dress up a rotting corpse. We're trying to glorify a rotting cancerous corpse. And this is a very profound truth. This is what we are engaged in. And I said the worst habit, we have a bad habit. We have the worst habit we have is to take whatever enthusiasm we have for the Holy Spirit glorifying perfection, which is the intermediate step that we need, to take that hope and then turn it back around and use it to generate more effort to keep putting more lipstick on this pig of a rotting corpse, cancerous corpse. This is the mistake, the bad habit that we have. And this is the bad habit that has to be broken. Otherwise, you're never going to make any progress on the spiritual path. You will not. And the full stop in the wow is how you break this bad habit. This bad habit has to be broken. It may take a lifetime to break it. It may take many lifetimes, or you could do it right now, actually. You could do it right now. Or it could take several years, or however long it takes. It has to be just simply, you have to break this habit. Otherwise, you're going to continue to pick at this rotting cancerous corpse, to pick at it and sort through it and try to put lipstick on it and say, oh, what a glorious rotting cancerous corpse you are. Gee, I really love this. And of course, inside you're saying, yuck, yuck, what a hideous dream this is, yuck. But you say, I got to get rid of this yuck by trying to glorify this rotting cancerous corpse. And it never works. It never works. It will never work. So when we get a glimpse of what does work, we cannot allow that motivation to then be hijacked by the arrogance and cause us to go right back into trying to glorify this corpse, like going, let's go plant some flowers, let's go make this, you know, rotting cancerous corpse more beautiful, let's try to glorify it. That's the mistake we make, and this habit is brutally ingrained, you know, in our habit, as a terrible habit. It's very ingrained, and so this is where you have to put your battle. This is where you put your effort, and you put your effort into full stop in the wow. See, I'm not going to do anything. When I have this insight, I'm just going to sit here, and I'm just going to get used to this wow. I'm not going to try to transform it into glorifying this rotting, cancerous corpse of a universe. Now, we've talked about we have this intermediate step, we have this continuity problem. We do. We are so accustomed to trying to glorify, oh, I got to redecorate. I've got to put this picture over here. I got to have this kind of thing. Oh, it's not quite right. I need to redecorate some more. I need to re-landscape. I need to get better clothes. I need to do the. I'm trying to glorify. We're trying to glorify, and we even claim that arrogance is God, and that therefore. What arrogance is telling us we must do, we keep thinking that's God telling us that we must do that. Almost all the religions, almost all of belief, almost all non-belief, secularism, you name it in this world, they're following the advice of arrogance. Some just say, well, it's just evolution, it's just the wisdom of the body, it's nature, it's just the way it is. And others say, well, it's God that's telling us, giving us this advice. Try to glorify the universe. That's arrogance. It's our own arrogance that is giving us this advice. It's not God at all. It's not God at all. But again, we're trying to glorify arrogance by calling it God. That's what arrogance tells us. You must glorify me by calling me God. I am your God. That's arrogance that we're trying to glorify. God doesn't need any glorification. But listen to this. We have a continuity fear because our functioning has been so wrapped up in trying to glorify. We believe that glorification is necessary for our happiness. If we don't have glorification, how can we be happy? We'll be miserable. This is a terrible dread we have to stop the effort of glorification. Now, I said reality doesn't need glorification. It doesn't. So if we experience reality, we'll say, it's perfect. This is absolutely perfect. I don't need to do anything. And then about our continuity fear. So, whoa, wait a minute. You say, if we don't glorify, we'll be miserable. So, there is this trouble we have. So, what does the Holy Spirit do? What does God do? What does the Holy Spirit do? Very simple. Very simple. And hear this now. And we'll give you a moment to compose yourself, because what we've said already is turned your whole belief system upside down. Everyone's belief system is just like, whoa. Wow. What do we do? What does the Holy Spirit do? Get this. I've never heard this. I don't think anyone's ever heard this. And Holy Spirit told me this morning, said, consider this. How about this? And I said, wow, this is really cool. What the Holy Spirit does is it glorifies perfection. It glorifies perfection. And we get to experience this glorification of perfection. Now you might say, okay, wow, wait, why? Okay, wow, what glorifying perfection. And we've said perfection doesn't need to be glorified. Absolutely it doesn't. In fact, perfection is immeasurably better than any glorification of perfection could ever be. However, the glorification of perfection enables us to maintain this belief in glorification so we don't get all freaked out about, if we don't have glorification, we're going to be miserable. But at the same time, it enables us to sort of get a mirror imagery of perfection. So that once we go through this glorification of perfection phase, then we're able to put down glorification altogether and just experience perfection exactly as it is without any needs at all. See, this is the genius. This is the way. This is the way of salvation, is accept the vision of glorified perfection. The vision of glorified perfection. Accept the vision, the universe of glorified perception. Accept a universe of glorified perfection. I think I might have said perception. No, glorified perfection. Glorified perfection. Now, this is still not perfection, which needs no glorification whatsoever. And any attempt to glorify perfection damns it with faint praise. That is true. That is absolutely true. But the Holy Spirit knows this. But we need this as an intermediate step. To leap straight into perfection is to drop all glorification efforts whatsoever as if they never had been. And we would think, we equate this with absolute misery and even annihilation and death. We equate that. So this equation must be let go of, but it's a very sensitive equation. And it's so sensitive, our continuity fear is so sensitive, we need to maintain this feeling of glorification until we get so used to this reflection of perfection, we say, you know what? I can even set down this glorification now. So we do have this intermediate step called the glorification of perfection. So we exchange the glorification of arrogance for the glorification of perception. What is the common denominator in this, these two equations? Glorification. That is the common denominator. So we have a continuity because we maintain a common denominator. It's just what we're glorifying changes. That's all. Instead of trying to glorify this universe, which is a dream of arrogance, we glorify perfection. Glorify perfection. And the glorification of perfection may take on an appearance of a universe. And it could even seem similar to this universe in many ways, right? But it would certainly be different because we feel like, oh, it feels like that I'm glorifying that which is perfect. Wow. Wow. And that's what is perfect is being glorified. And it would be extremely beautiful. Jesus tells us it's just, you cannot even describe the gentle beauty and just how extraordinarily wonderful it is. So I heard this from the Holy Spirit in terms of, not auditorily, but in terms of an idea. You know, I got the idea. It registered. I said, wow, let me entertain this idea. Holy Spirit floats ideas out there for us, and then we can entertain them or not, but it's kind of like an idea will come and say, hey, how about this idea? You know, how about looking at it like this? How about this perspective? I just saw this perspective, and the feeling was like, well, maybe I should take a look at this perspective. That's the Holy Spirit at work. Is it glorifying perfection? What an extraordinary perspective. I never have I looked at it that way before. Glorifying perfection. Wow. So extraordinary, you know, it commands attention. Now, again, what is the bad habit we have? We have an extraordinary bad habit, which is to anything that tends to build up hope and motivation in us, we then transfer that over to trying even more vigorously to glorify arrogance. This is our bad habit. And this is a bad habit that has to be broken. And so in any situation that is helping out in this world, you really have to take pragmatic steps to help break this bad habit, because it's an extreme bad habit. And it's sinking your ship. It's like a leak in your ship that's sinking your ship. You have to plug that leak. So there are pragmatic steps that need to be taken to break this bad habit. Once this bad habit is broken, then we will feel free to accept the glorification of perfection, and we won't try to turn it back into a campaign to glorify arrogance. You see, this is the trouble. And our habits are extremely entrenched in trying to glorify arrogance, extremely entrenched. So we have to take very artful, pragmatic steps to work on breaking this habit. And this is what we resist. This is why the spiritual path is so difficult for us. This habit, bad habit we have, which keeps sabotaging our progress. It keeps sabotaging our momentum. We keep sabotaging ourselves. So if you wonder, how come I'm having so much trouble? We're sabotaging by trying to reinvest into glorifying arrogance. Now, the activity of virtually everyone in this world to a very large extent, is trying to glorify arrogance. And this is something we need to accept and repent on, and not be hard-headed about. You see, that's why repentance is so important. Repentance is saying, you know what, I have a really, really, not only have I tried to usurp the place of God through a dream of arrogance, but I have an extremely bad habit of trying to glorify arrogance. And any momentum, any hope I get, I turn back into trying to glorify arrogance. I have an extremely bad habit. This is called repentance. And once you acknowledge you have this extremely bad habit, then you're willing to abide by certain restrictions, pragmatic crutches, helps you break this habit. It's a no-brainer. You say, wow, what can I do to break this terrible habit? And this habit will bite you over and over and over and over again. And yet you have to bounce back and say, let me try, you know, better to break this bad habit. Now, this habit is so severe, and this is so unacknowledged in the world, that most of the people who go for spiritual help, they're looking for help. They're looking to feel motivated. They want to be fired up and inspired so they can do a better job glorifying arrogance. That's the reason why almost everyone goes to see any spiritual teaching or teacher. That's why they're going. Actually, they don't realize that, because it's not being pointed out to them. It's not being pointed out to them that they have to repent, and they have to acknowledge they have a terrible habit. So there's a lot of pseudo-spiritual teaching going on, in my opinion. It's not really tough enough love. It's not being pragmatic enough. And so you get these people who feel that they're skilled in glorifying arrogance, and they go to the spiritual satsang or something, and they're trying to get inspired by the teacher, the situation, say, how can I redecorate arrogance so it's to glorify it, you know, so I feel happy with it. And, you know, no one's pointing out, hey, you need to repent before you can come to any spiritual situation. Otherwise, you're just making things worse. And so there needs to be, people need to be in a mood of repentance, and they need to stabilize that. The Holy Spirit floated an idea to me this morning, and I said, whoa. This is not going to go over well. And the Holy Spirit said, what do you see in these so-called spiritual teachers of the world right now? What do you notice around them? I said, well, you've pointed out many times about, you know, 70 to 90% of those who are around the spiritual teacher, any video, any picture you see, it's always the same. It's all women. It's all women. It's totally out of balance. Totally out of balance. And the Holy Spirit says, well, why? And now I know that, of course, women are very good decorators. They're very good costumers. They're very good at dressing up the situation, you know, putting lipstick on a pig. And so they're going there to the spiritual teacher saying, I think I can help the world. They feel I have this wonderful innate capacity as a woman to help the world because I know how to dress up and make something that may be ugly, hide the ugliness and make it look beautiful. This is about the whole idea of makeovers, of makeup, of hiding flaws. They said, we're really great at that, so we can help the world. So I'm going to go to the spiritual teacher, and I'm going to be inspired to help the world. This is why they're there, for the most part. Some may be there legitimately because they're repentant, see. But it's way out of balance. It's completely out of balance. It's so extremely out of balance, it's just absurd. Imagine if they're, you know, anyway, it's obvious it's out of balance. So the Holy Spirit said, look, how about if you are going to help out, break this bad habit, that you insist that every woman that comes has to be chaperoned by a conservative male, right? By a conservative male. You know, who's grounded in very strict morality, conservative principles, you know. So this, they have to be chaperoned. This is a system. Of course, women always used to be chaperoned throughout history. It's only in the last 50 years or so that women were not chaperoned. If women went out on a date, they'd be chaperoned. If they went to a dance, they'd be chaperoned. This helped keep things in balance. Okay, this is something that's been always throughout history. It's a very important, in the last 50 years have just shown what happens. It's been a radical experiment with women. And what happens when you drop the system of checks and balances? And it's, of course, from the perspective of many, it's been an absolute disaster. Absolute disaster, what has happened. So the Holy Spirit says, how about going back to the chaperone system? And I said, wow, that's going to create a furor. And I said, but I like the idea, you know, why not? Why not? You can't come to see the teacher unless you're chaperone by a male chaperone. It can be your father. So it actually should be someone older. Most chaperones was done by your grandparents, your older generation. So if you want to come see a spiritual teacher, bring your grandfather to chaperone you. And of course, I told the Holy Spirit that most of the modern women are going to absolutely hit the roof and have a spaz attack at this. You know, they're going to be absolutely furious. But that in itself shows that it's hitting the nail on the head, isn't it? Why such extreme resistance to this? And you know what? The grandfather will be greatly benefited from coming too. The fact is that men are so intimidated right now by modern women who insist they have the answer, and because this modern world is gung-ho on glorifying arrogance, it seems that women do have the inside track because they're much better at makeovers and dressing up something ugly to make, you know, dressing up a cancerous corpse to make it look like it's alive, or, you know, that they seem to have the inside track. And so men are very intimidated now. They don't even bother even going. I've heard this again and again from men. They say, I went to see this so-called teacher. It was all these, you know, young, aggressive women and I just felt like I didn't even belong at all. I had no voice there at all. No voice there, and just, I'm pushed to the side. Like I'm just, you know, useless, nobody. Why even go? So men are just being devastated by this. And they're losing interest in spirituality altogether because they think they don't belong. But the truth is that this modern spirituality is just an attempt to glorify arrogance, okay? And the women think they have an inside track on that. So we can do that better than you men, which is, you know, it may be a fact, but it's hardly a fact to cheer about, right? It's hardly a fact to cheer about. In fact, it's women that have to be most careful about and make sure that they have checks and balances on this urge, like, hey, I can glorify arrogance, really, I'm really clever at it. They're the ones who have to watch that very carefully. Because that is the ego, that is the ego. Okay, glorifying arrogance is our terrible, terrible habit. And women tend to ease into that habit and have been in easier than men. Okay, so they have to be very careful. So they should be chaperoned. They should be watched after by the older conservative people. Older people are naturally more conservative. Okay, believe it or not, as you get older, you get more conservative. This is checks and balances. You cannot have the young people running the show on their own. This is a disaster. And the disaster is so obvious that, you know, if you don't see it, then there's something severely wrong with you, I would say. Severely, it is so out of whack right now, society, so out of whack. It's in free fall. And I think doing away with the chaperone system is what collapsed it, actually. Is the older generation was kicked to the curb, says, we don't want you telling us what to do, we're liberated, you know. Women's liberation is the root of this disaster that has happened in this world. Spiritual disaster. Social disaster. People can't even think straight anymore. You know, it's unbelievable how they take things out of context, how they twist things, how hypocritical they are. They're riddled with egoic arrogance, and so it is just a disaster. So we'll go back to the chaperone system, is where the young people have the older people, especially the young women have older people there to keep them in check, because they're just fired up and on fire, thinking that, you know, we're going to save the world. We're going to save arrogance from being recognized as being this rotting, cancerous corpse that it actually is. We're going to dress it up so good you can't even tell. This is what's going on. This is so prevalent that the habit now, being pulled into that habit, is so easy to get pulled into that habit. When you get a glimpse of your freedom, you say, wow, I could really use this feeling I have, like I can turn this to really glorifying the world, you know, glorifying the universe. Then you make things worse. So it's a diabolical situation we're in right now. Very much so. So the Holy Spirit said, yeah, nobody can come see you unless they have an elder chaperone. Let's make it like an older chaperone. No, you're not going to bring some totally dominated young man who's so totally in awe of, you know, the ferocity of women that he, you know, is just completely whipped and is just a bowl of jello, you know. No. How about bring your grandfather or your uncle, older uncle, right? Or your great-grandfather or your dad, right? That'll be a revelation. That'll be a revelation. Because we all have to break this bad habit. And the idea that women don't have to break this bad habit is totally insane. And it does extreme delay to everyone. They think, oh, we don't have to do that. We can dress up. We know how to dress up this corpse, so it'll satisfy us. No, you don't. No. Nobody can. Nobody can. It will never satisfy us. A dream of arrogance will never satisfy us. We are perfection itself, period. We are perfection itself. And only that will satisfy us. We cannot use this realization that we're perfection itself to dress up arrogance to satisfy us truly. We cannot. It's impossible. And so the realization that this is impossible has to permeate society. And right now it's the opposite. Society is drunk on the wine of the whores of Babylon, thinking that they can dress up the dream of arrogance, this rotting, cancerous corpse. So we'll also be able to say, oh, I'm so happy, I'm so satisfied. This is it. This is home for me. You know, this is my life. It will never work. There's zero possibility that will ever work. So the tide has to be turned. The tide has to be turned. So in order to prevent it from getting worse, which it could, I really feel in some ways a lot of these various spiritual teachers in the world are making things worse because they're empowering the feminist who come to them and empowering them, thinking, yeah, okay, they learn the buzzwords, they do this, okay, they learn it, okay, and they think, okay, now I've got the poise to, you know, dress arrogance up. I got the poise to do that. They're coming there to try to figure out some sort of poise in centering this so that they can pursue this objective even more extremely. This is what's happening. And so it's making it worse. It's making it worse. To turn the tide, you have to, as the Holy Spirit suggested, use the chaperone system. I'd never thought of that before. It was just like, wow. I said, well, no one would come and see me, Holy Spirit, if that was the case. He says, well, maybe some will. Maybe some will. It's like, come on, Dad. Come on, Dad. I want to go see this spiritual teacher. You got to come with me. So I have to be chaperone. And the dad says, I'm not interested in that spiritual stuff, you know. What you're basically saying is, I'm whipped, I'm beat, I'm, you know, what's the use? We can't win. It's impossible. So no, I have to come. Either I was, I can't come. I can't go. So, come on, Dad. Okay. So the dad comes and, you know, hey, welcome, Dad. Great to see you. Glad you could be here. And we're going to hear some interesting stuff here. We'll start practicing full stop in the wow. You see? And then the women sit on one side and the men sit on the other side. This is another very important thing to break this extremely bad habit of the times, to turn the tide, to help balance things out. Because women can be extremely persuasive with men and get their way. They really have run the world from the very beginning. Men are basically their foot soldiers. Throughout history, have just been their foot soldiers, their infantry, to pursue their ambition. The ambition being to glorify arrogance. That's the ambition that, that arrogance has. And just the way that, that it it has been set up is that the really the ambition of women is what drives men. As they say, behind every successful man, meaning some very ambitious successful man, is a woman. That is absolutely, usually, not always true. Actually, well, an ambitious man, yeah, because he's just the ambition of his mother, his sisters, his aunts, his grandmothers, etc. They channel that through the man as to be a foot soldier for their ambition, actually. So these are super bad habits that, that the tide has to turn on this. Right now, it's high tide for a collapsing civilization. There's no question about it. The incapacity to reason and give benefit the doubt of context. It's become so partisan. It's become so partisan now that reason is out the window. Okay. And when reason goes out the window, you know, disaster here, disaster. So, you know, those who have leverage have to use it. They have to use it. And they have to forego the notion that, well, I want to be some super guru. So if I can get, you know, 1 million women to come see me, I'll be really famous and that's okay. And I don't want to say anything that might, quote unquote, offend them. This idea of being offended is so ridiculous, you know. People are so eager to be offended, they take something out of context, they twist it, and they don't give somebody any chance to clarify. I mean, somebody may misspeak or say something in a crass way, and later they say, well, this is the context I meant, you know. And then people say, oh yeah, okay, I understood what the context was. And most intelligent people are listening in a context to say, okay, this is pointing to something. So what are they pointing to? What's the context they're pointing to? And then they get from the words, they kind of put it together, and they arrive, 1, 2, 3, okay. And if it's a little ragged, they say, oh, I understand what the purpose of what they're saying, what the context is. Okay, I get it. But now, what legalism is saying, if we don't like you, we're going to pin you down on the exact words you say. So if you misspeak in the slightest bit, are not perfectly clear, we're going to claim we can't understand what you're saying at all, and that you really mean this terrible thing or something. They refuse to use any contextual understanding whatsoever if they want to attack somebody. This is what's going on in the world. The media is extremely that way now. Where in the past people would listen to context, and they said, well, I know this is what he meant. Yeah, I know he said this, but this is actually what he was getting at. So I'm not offended. What are you talking about? Offended? It's ridiculous. So we have a culture of offense, taking offense now, and they've become experts at it. And this is a terrible thing to be an expert at, actually. It's the lowest of the lowest of the lowest. It's slavery to arrogance. When you're an expert at taking offense, that's slavery to arrogance. Plain and simple. Nothing more than that. Now, it seems to me that people should be eager to break their bad habit, because their bad habit is literally chaining them to death, chaining them to this rotting, cancerous corpse. You know, you are absolutely chained and bound to this rotting, cancerous corpse. This is a fact. Through your habits, through your bad habits, especially that one bad habit. If you break that one bad habit, all others will go. It's like there's a chain, your chain, and there's a lock. If you cut through that lock, you can unwrap all the chains. All the chains will fall off you. Okay? Or even if you cut through one link of the chain. Okay. So you have to be able to cut through that lock. So, all right? You have to cut through it. The bad habit. The one bad habit that's really chaining you. And there's no other remedy. You don't break that bad habit, you're not going to get... Things will just get worse. So... if you want to get free of that rotting, cancerous corpse that you're chained to, you have to break this bad habit. So everyone should be eager to do what it takes, eager to do this. And of course, it's difficult. It's very difficult. But you have to get going on it. And you say, however long it takes, you know, this is my life, because I'm tired of being chained to this rotting, cancerous corpse. And I know if I don't break it, I'm going to stay chained to it. That's what I realized when I was 22. I realized for sure if I didn't break this bad habit, I would remain chained to this rotting cancerous corpse. Whether I die or not die, it makes no difference. I will remain chained for sure. And then I said, I have no choice. I have to just simply work at it as intensely as possible until I get it done. There's no way around it whatsoever. And when you see there's no way around it, then you really get working on it. And for me, it was realizing reincarnation was true. I realized there's no way around it. Death does not free me from it at all. I had the exact same problems I had in a previous life. They stay with you. They stay with you. Arrogance doesn't die when the body dies. Okay, arrogance is a spiritual desire. It doesn't die when the body dies at all. So this will start turning the tide, because these whores of Babylon are so absolutely full of themselves right now that they're really trying to entrain all women on the planet into their madness, actually. That they're saying, yeah, we can get it done. We know how to do it. We can put a wig on the rotting corpse and everybody will want to stay, want to embrace this rotting cancerous corpse forever. We just put this really nice wig, you know, beautiful wig on it. And yeah, they're trying to entrain everyone on this planet into that. So the Holy Spirit must know that there are many who are very desperate to say, I don't want to do that. I don't want to be entrained in that way. You know, people are over the top with their arrogance. And this is just producing terrible habit in me, very bad habit that I've, you know, the women have been trying to break this bad habit, as have men, both, for a long time. And to throw away all the momentum and progress that we have made toward breaking this bad habit, you cannot have a worse situation than that. This situation in the world is about as bad as it can get right now. Because the world is entraining with all the media, all the multimedia, all the news, all the entertainment, all the politicians, just about all, are entraining us to throw away all progress that we've made to breaking this bad habit and to go back to embracing the attempt to glorify arrogance full on. And this is a spiritual disaster. A spiritual disaster. If there's one bad habit and you have to break this and you give up your efforts to do so, and in fact end up trying to reinforce this bad habit, that's the very definition of a spiritual disaster. That is the definition. It's the poster child. This present age is the poster child for a spiritual disaster. It is the poster child for spiritual disaster, plain and simple. So it's time to out the whole situation. So let's call upon all women spiritual teachers to insist that every woman that comes to their see them must have an older male chaperoning them. Let's call them out. Officially, we're calling them all out. All spiritual teachers must insist upon this, okay? This is the advice of the Holy Spirit. All spiritual teachers must insist upon this, that any women that come to see them must have an elder chaperone. An elder male chaperone. Elder male chaperone. To start turning this dreadful tide of entrainment by the horrors of Babylon that is going on. And for someone to say, well, I'm not bothered by that, is ridiculous. Ridiculous. We do not live in a vacuum. Okay, the mind is one. The consciousness of this planet is like a fish swimming in the ocean. When the ocean is polluted, doesn't that affect the fish? When radiation enters the ocean from a nuclear disaster like Fukushima, doesn't that radiation affect the fish in the ocean? Of course it does. So we have this terrible, terrible spiritual disaster taking place in this world. That certainly affects everybody on this planet. And to say that, oh, no, I'm not affected, I don't need this, is nonsense. So we'll find out who's naughty and who's nice here. We'll find out who picks up on this idea that because the women have been under insane pressure to be entrained into this. Unbelievable pressure. You know, yes, we can. Yes, we can. We can do it. We can do it. Yes, we can. They even got a yes man in the White House cheering them on. Yes, we can. Yes, we can. Yes, we can. We can do this. Yes, we can. We can dress up arrogance, this rotting, cancerous corpse, so that we want to remain in its embrace forever. You know, yes, we can do that. And so they're trying to entrain. Once women are entrained, men are just balls of jello. You know, just quivering jello. That's all. Almost all. Few rare exceptions who have worked extremely diligently to avoid this and to worked on breaking their own habits. But most men are just quivering jello. Quivering jello. They can't say anything, hardly. And when one of them does, you know, all the rest of them just completely freak out. What are you talking about? You want me to stand up to the women in my life who are spiritually superior to me? Are you kidding me? Are you crazy? I just got to worship them and do what they tell me to do. That's the reaction of most men in these days. If any man stands up and dares, you know, to say something relevant or important, most men are just like, young men especially, are just completely freak out. She says, my girlfriend's going to kill me. Girlfriend's going to kill me. If she knows that I listen to this, or even agree, or interested, she's going to kill me. I mean, yeah, guys like, maybe they're reading books or something, hiding, you know, under their covers, like, or whatever. Oh, she's out of the house. Okay, let me look at this now. Oh, she's back. Oh, my God, you know. I'll be killed. She's going to hear all the time from me. My wife would kill me. My girlfriend would kill me. Well, they're not joking. They're not joking. What they do is put them under some sort of double, triple spiritual probation, you know, where if you ever do that again, well, you're going to be, you know, drawn and quartered, basically. This is the attitude of most young men, and most older men, too, at this age, at time, actually. Not entirely. Some of the older men are not quite that bad, but they're still nervous about it. And so the tide has to be turned. This is a situation that's so out of control right now in the world. Again, it is the poster child for spiritual disaster right now. And of course, the whores of Babylon are insisting that we're on the brink of success, ultimate success. They say we've almost dressed arrogance up, almost glorified arrogance to the point where you're just going to want to love arrogance forever. You know, almost there. And so people are saying, oh my God, we're almost there. This is a spiritual new age. We're in a new age. This is the poster child for spiritual disaster. We're not going into some great new age. We are going into some dreadful period of dark, spiritual darkness right now. So call out the gurus. I call out all the gurus. I don't need to call them by name. You all know who you are. So I'm calling every single one of you out right now today, July 3rd, 2015. Insist that every woman that comes to see you has a chaperone. Now, what about the older women? Okay. Well, they can't bring an older chaperone too, so we're not. We have to be pragmatic. You know, bring your husband. Bring your, you know, bring someone who's conservative. You say if he's younger, if it's a 90-year-old woman coming to satsang or coming to spiritual practice, then, you know, bring a conservative male with you. Well, I don't know any. Well, find one. Find one. And just say, hey, I got a problem. I can't go see a spiritual teacher unless I have a conservative male with me. Would you help me out? The conservative male will say, well, okay, yeah, I like that. The teacher's conservative. He's trying to balance. I like that, you know. So I'm calling every single guru out right now with apostolic authority, okay? I'm risking my relationship with Jesus by doing this, but I don't feel Jesus is going to dump me because of this, all right? Not at all. I don't feel that way. We'll see, you know, but, you know, I'm not somebody that, I wouldn't dump myself at all. You see, I would not dump myself at all. What I'm saying is valuable. This is very valuable information that I'm talking about here, about this idea of accepting the vision of glorifying perfection as the intermediate step. It, absolutely it is. That is the inner. We don't have to do anything. The Holy Spirit does that for us. So we don't need any women to do a makeover of arrogance to accomplish this. We don't need makeup artists. You know, those are really good at styling hair and putting makeup on and dressing things up very good, which we don't need that at all. Okay, the glorification of perfection is brought about, is presented to us by the Holy Spirit. Period. We just enjoy it, is all. We just enjoy it. So it's that simple. So this is a great day, calling out all spiritual teachers on the planet, calling them all out. Situation's so out of control. You think, well, what about men? Well, they're not so out of control, although some of them are. I mean, the younger ones are very out of control. They should, maybe they should have to bring an elderly conservative woman to satsang too, you know? That's an idea. Maybe they need to bring their grandmother. But a lot of the elder women have been entrained by the young feminists. They're trying to be young again. The feminists say, hey, you know, if you do this, you'll be forever young. And they say, wow, okay. You got some granny in a miniskirt, you know? Say, so, yeah. Granny in a wig and a miniskirt. And she says, you know, I'm young. Give me that female Viagra. I feel young again, you know. I'm empowered. So maybe that doesn't work so well, you know. So maybe the young men need to get a conservative man to come. We can work that out, but we'll start with the women for sure. They're the ones that are most out of control. They're severely out of control. And the ones who don't want that will be happy to say, yeah, this really helps. This really helps. Because the women I associate with are trying to contaminate me. You know, more and more they're contaminating me with this arrogance, extreme arrogance. But hey, we know how to glorify arrogance so that everyone will be perfectly satisfied, spiritually satisfied, which of course is an impossibility, an impossibility. And we're not going to have the women hog the spotlight, you know, around some teacher. As a matter of fact, they need to step back in the background. They're jumping into the foreground has been a disaster. They have absolutely shamed themselves by going full in with egoic arrogance. All right. And so they need to take a step back right now. Say, whoa, wait a minute. I don't want to go off that cliff. We're at a time now where people are ready to take next steps off the cliff. Okay, everyone needs to take a step back and say, wait a minute. Now, Mr. Donald Trump is in the news. I don't like Donald Trump, okay? Because he glamorizes women. He promotes the glamorization of women. And that's a bad thing. He promotes princess culture, which is basically the same thing, dressing up arrogance. Say, oh, look how beautiful this rotting cancerous corpse is. Look at this woman, she's so beautiful. This rotting cancerous corpse is, don't you want her? Isn't she wonderful? Isn't she lovely? Isn't she lovely? And most musicians, too, are despicable glamorizers of women. Oh, you know, this rotting cancerous corpse is so beautiful, so wonderful. I just lose my mind. You know, this is despicable. So I don't like the Donald. I don't like him. He walked right past me once at Pebble Beach golf course. And, you know, I saw him playing golf there. But I don't like him, and I can stand up to him, okay? So, but I understand, you know, not everyone, we're all caught up in these bad habits, okay? He has some bad habits, right? It doesn't make him all bad, okay? It doesn't make him all bad. So I also have forgiveness and a balanced perspective of the whole situation. You know, but he is like causing people to freak out right now, absolutely freak out. Yeah, and this just shows how out of balance the whole thing. He's actually performing he's a useful idiot, let's put it that way. And sometimes useful idiots can be very helpful. And he is bringing to light the insane imbalance in this world, just how messed up everything is, that people can't even, you know, they're just losing their minds. It's just losing their minds. The only person so far that hasn't seemed to lose their mind is Arnold Schwarzenegger. And I don't really like Arnold either, because he glamorizes the body too, the body culture. But he's not a man that is easily pushed around, you see? And he said, hey, you know, who am I? His editor? I'm not his editor. He has to fine-tune his message. You know, he's going to make mistakes. He's going to say stuff he wish he didn't said. He needs to fine-tune his mistakes. You know, this is just the way it is. He's the only person. It's pretty interesting. So there are a few alpha males who are still not, who have not yet been completely intimidated by the feminists. And then there are a few spiritual people, both male and female, who are not easily intimidated. I'm not intimidated by either Schwarzenegger or the Donald at all. So someone, I can speak up. But again, I don't, both of those men actually have very bad habits, and I would chastise them that they need to, you know, they need to work on their bad habit. They need to break the bad habit too. You know, absolutely they do. But that's not what people are saying at all. They're basically saying, how dare you interrupt our script? How dare you interrupt our script, you know, like that. And so, you know, they don't listen to what's being said at all. They say, hey, you interrupted our script. We hate you. You're scaring us to death. You know, that's not the way you glorify arrogance. We have a better way. That's all it's all about, is they say, we have a better way. I mean, Trump is basically saying, look, I know how to glorify arrogance, and this is the way. And then the other feminists say, no. We know the way to glorify arrogance. This is the way. So this is the argument that's going on. It's an argument of two camps arguing over how do we glorify arrogance. But that's what's really taking place. And I'm saying that's both of those are nonsense. And both of them need to shut up and sit down and start right spiritual practice. They both need to be chaperoned. I mean, Trump should be chaperoned by some elderly Catholic woman or something, you know? Some super conservative elderly Catholic woman should be chaperoning him. Says, no, you can't do that. You know, where are all these floozies that you're hanging out with, you know? No, you can't hang out with those. Look how you're dressing your women. That's shameful. Shameful. So, anyway, we're going to make sure that the situation isn't sabotaged. Whatever situation arises, we make sure it's not sabotaged from the get-go. And the women have to have these chaperones, absolutely. And we'll, to start out, that and we'll see what else has to be chaperoned. There has to be this balance now. We have to bring some balance back in the situation. People have neglected the elder generation to an extreme extent because they say, we don't want to be chaperoned. We want to develop every bad habit possible. We want to engage to the max in this bad habit of reinvesting everything into trying to glorify arrogance. They want to do that. How are we doing here on the... Okay. So... The elder generation has been kicked to the curb in the most extreme way in the history of this planet. Never before has this anything like this ever happened. Never has an elder generation been so dumped in the garbage dump, neglected, scorned, despised by the younger generation. I hear from parents all the time, it says, my kids just think I'm a complete idiot and I have nothing to tell them. It's just bizarre, absolutely bizarre. This is a terrible... Never happened before in history like this. We keep saying, oh no, this is the way it's always been. No, it hasn't. Younger generation was always chaperoned by the elder generation. Always. And they respected them. And they realized if they didn't toe the line, they would be punished. Of course, nowadays, the younger generation says, you can't punish us at all. You can't, it's illegal. You know, well, guess what? If you want If you want to have the opportunity to break your bad habits, you're going to have to accept some discipline to do that. We're not going to give you free rein, not at all. Because you won't be able to break the bad habit if you just give free rein to your bad habits. It's not going to work that way. whether here or someone else. Someday you're going to have to pay the piper. You might as well start paying it right now. You have added a humility, realizing, and repentance, realizing, I can't do it. Yes, I cannot. I am an absolute perfect failure. I cannot dress up this rotting corpse, rotting cancerous corpse of arrogance, which is the body of arrogance as this universe. I cannot dress it up so that it, I cannot glorify it so that we truly love it. I cannot do it. I'm a perfect failure at this. So you come in the mood of, I am, yes, I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect failure. Well, I imagine there are some who would be absolutely furious at this. Well, they were absolutely furious with Jesus, weren't they? When he came here 2,000 years ago. And the apostles, they're furious with the apostles. And they say, you know, how dare you? How dare you, you know, suggest that we give up this effort to glorify arrogance? How dare you point out that our attempt to call arrogance God is a mistake? How dare you? They were furious with him. Some said, wow, this is what we've been waiting for. Thank you. So, same situation. Jesus is back now, has already returned. May 1st, 2:15. And he says, I came to bring not peace, but a sword to divide the sheep and the goats. So, we'll find out who really wants to break this bad habit. We'll find out who was truly repentant and says, I can't do it. I don't want to keep trying to do it. Forget it. I don't want to keep trying to do it. Bring your poor old neglected, scorned father or grandfather or uncle, you know, relative, some male who feels that he's worthless. Everyone hates him. All the younger people hate him. He has nothing to say, nothing to offer. He's an idiot, you know. Bring them along. Help them out. I'm being paged. Forget it. Bring them along, okay? Bring them along. They'll thank you for it, for sure. And you'll thank them, too, at some point. Realize, wow, I was out of my mind here. This modern culture is the devil in disguise. Or actually, it's not even in disguise anymore. It truly is the devil, which is the desire to glorify arrogance. That's the devil. That really is the devil. I got in voicemail. Well, I have to listen to this, but that it absolutely is the devil. And you want to take a step back from that and then start fleeing from it. Just a stupid, distracting call there, you know. Typical. Like someone has nothing better to do, you know, than try to pay attention to such nonsense. So, hopefully I'll have some, you know, I'll have enough spine to do this and support by the Holy Spirit to do this. I agree, I'll do this. Absolutely. I've actually been wanting to do this my whole life, but it just seems like you cannot get any traction here to do it. Absolutely none. You'll be absolutely rejected to the max. I mean, there's certainly a contingent that will completely reject this. Just utterly and completely reject this with just absolute scorn. These are the whores of Babylon, and those who have been, you know, entrained along by them. And they'll say, how dare you, how dare you, how dare you, how dare you. What do you mean? There's no dare to it. It's not daring. It's just helping. Not daring, it's helping. It's pragmatism. It's what has to be done. Tide has to be turned. Either now or later, it has to be turned. The delay doesn't do any good at all. It just makes things worse. So this, again, this is the poster child for spiritual collapse, and there's a great cry for help here. So we're answering the cry for help. And this is the discipline that we have to engage in here, pragmatically. There's no two ways about it. And again, they may say, well, I'm going to go to some teacher who doesn't ask me to do that. Well, go ahead. But I've already told them that this is what they need to do. They've already been notified this is what they need to do. If they don't do it, then okay, they're not listening. They're putting, you know, maybe their own fame ahead of pragmatism, what actually works. Again, you know, if you come out and support the horse of Babylon, you know, they'll promote you like crazy. Make sure that you're the top teacher in the world, you know, because you're supporting their agenda. Of course they will. Then they'll dump you and say, well, you're an idiot. You don't really know, you're a male. You don't know what you're talking about anyway. So you just need to work for us as a slave. They'll say, well, make you an honorary woman. You look like a woman to me. You got long hair and you dress a certain way. You sort of seem like a woman. You got the heart of a woman. So, you know, we'll go easy on you kind of thing. We can kind of trust you. You know, we can, you're sort of an honorary part of the sisterhood. We can trust you. That kind of thing. That's what they do. We'll make you real famous. Yeah, fabulous day, huh? Fabulous day. Fabulous day to get this information out, this pressure out now. This is a great declaration. Yeah, only great clarity can see this and see, yeah, this needs to be done. Again, glorify perfection. The vision of glorified perfection. The glorification of perfection, the vision of the glorification of perfection, which is the final judgment of God upon us. That is the final judgment. The final judgment of God upon us is this glorification of perfection. That's it. That's what we get. We say, okay, God, I insist that I experience your final judgment upon me right now. God, I insist that I experience your final judgment upon me right now. That is the glorification of perfection that you'll experience. That's what you'll experience. Wonderful. Okay, this is about an hour here. In fact, it is. And I want to limit this to about an hour. Because this is very intense. I want you to consider this and really get going and considering this. Very great. That's it for this one.